This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
His death shook the nation.
George Floyd!
His life became a global symbol for racial injustice and police brutality. Now, 1 year after the police killing of George Floyd, where does America go from here?
We, the jury, in the above-entitled matter, find the defendant guilty.
A former Minneapolis police officer has been convicted of murdering Floyd.
Today, we are able to breathe again.
But as police killings have continued across the country in recent weeks, we examine the lasting effects of systemic racism, the lingering distrust between communities of color and law enforcement, and the trauma that remains for so many. This is Race Matters, America After George Floyd. Welcome to this PBS NewsHour special. I'm Judy Woodruff. It was 1 year ago that George Floyd's slow and agonizing death was captured on cell phone video. The footage showed Floyd pinned beneath Officer Derek Chauvin's knee for more than 9 minutes, unable to breathe. That video sparked widespread outrage. Protesters took to the streets in cities around the world, demanding justice and new restrictions on police. Many police and their unions fought back. They distanced themselves from Derek Chauvin and argued that they routinely respond to dangerous situations where they must make split-second decisions.
This isn't stained by someone in Minneapolis. It's still got a shine on it.
Last month, after his own police chief testified against him, Chauvin was convicted of murder. But the debate over how to address police violence continues. Over the past year, cities and states have enacted laws that ban chokeholds, expand the use of body cameras, and require that police intervene if one of their fellow officers is using excessive force. And roughly 1,500 police reform bills are still pending in state legislatures.
I rise to support this bill.
At the federal level, the George Floyd Justice in Policing Act has stalled in Congress after passing the House in a largely party-line vote. It aims to limit use of force, increase accountability, and improve police training. Meanwhile, the questions around excessive force haven't ceased. Since Floyd's death, more than 900 people have been shot and killed by police, according to a Washington Post database. And recent studies have found Black Americans are more than 2.5 times more likely to be killed by police than white Americans. Researchers and community leaders say persistent racial bias and a history of discrimination are a big part of this disparity. But police officers are rarely prosecuted. Only about 1% of police are arrested for fatal shootings each year, and about a third of those are convicted of any charge. So while some are hoping for justice in the courtroom, others say to truly address racism in this country, much more still needs to change. Tonight, we look at how the country is grappling with racial inequities through the lens of three cities. We'll discuss what has changed over the last year and what still needs to be done to create a more equitable future. Amna Nawaz begins our special coverage in Minneapolis, the home of George Floyd.
Before the trial, before the verdict, before the protests and the marches, before this latest debate over policing reform and the racial reckoning across America, before all of that, there was this, the corner of 38th and Chicago on the south side of Minneapolis, the place where George Floyd was murdered and where a movement was born.
Well, good morning.
It's 8 o'clock in the morning at George Floyd Square. Marsha Howard has already been here for hours.
Let's just be gentle with each other so we can be dangerous together.
She's a fixture here, watching over this now sacred ground. A year ago, Howard was teaching English at Roosevelt High School just down the road. Her Instagram was filled with pies and flowers and carefully curated scenes. Friends jokingly called her Marsha Stewart. That all changed when George Floyd was murdered.
I am a retired Marine. I joined during a war, and the idea that we would have the military come up my street and the MPD and the National Guard form a phalanx right here, precisely right here, broke something inside of me that had once been whole.
It broke something, you say?
It broke something. I couldn't sleep, I couldn't eat, I couldn't do anything. I couldn't. And so if I was awake, I was out here. And because I was always awake, I was always out here.
Over the last year, this site has evolved from protest zone to a place of mourning to a movement for change. Now barricaded, it's run by the community itself, demanding reform before the barriers come down.
George Floyd Square is now a memorial, but it also it signifies that this intersection stands for us saying no more. We're done. We're done with status quo when status quo is the summary execution of black people and brown people and indigenous people. We're done. We're done.
For a year, the world's attention had been trained on Minneapolis. The viral video of Floyd's death, protests and violence, calls to abolish police. Events at times caught outsiders by surprise, but some here called it inevitable.
A majority white population created conditions that at a certain point you say, well, if my life means nothing, if the life of my family means nothing, if you are going to not listen to us, then the only way that I'm going to get you to listen is to get in your face, is to make you very uncomfortable and start asking very uncomfortable questions.
Journalist Justin Ellis, born and raised here, is writing a book on being black in Minneapolis. The Twin Cities have some of the nation's worst racial disparities. From median household income and home ownership, the gaps between white and black families here are some of the widest in America. Ellis says racist policies and outcomes are hidden in Minnesota beneath a perception that the state welcomes everyone regardless of race.
When you think about George Floyd, a man who came from Houston, who came here because there were specific programs that people had told him about that could help you turn your life around. Here, I think about my own family. I think about all the different refugees who have come here over the years. And that's the thing that to me always just felt really damning, is that Minnesota perpetuates this idea that this is going to be a place that will be safe and that this will be a place that will be open and inviting.
And in reality?
And the reality of that is that it is only those things if you are white.
That's a reality 23-year-old Isak Dua has lived his whole life. The son of immigrants, he grew up just miles from George Floyd Square.
In Minnesota, like, the most racist experiences I've had have been with people that I'm sure would argue that they're a liberal. They might have like the Black Lives Matter bumper sticker, but they harbor, you know, intense resentment for African-American people.
Isak's father, Remy, is from the Ivory Coast. His mother, Thorin, from Iceland. They came to the U.S. in the 1980s, met at the University of Minnesota, and had Isak in 1998. Together, they learned that raising him in America would be different than in their home countries.
So you don't come and say, I'm going to raise a black child. You say, I'm going to raise a child, a human being. It will and you do your best to raise that human being to function in society. It's society that forces you to see your child as black and white.
As Isak grew, so did his mother's fears, especially with each new video of police violence against black men. The last year, she says, has been hell.
And, you know, mothers of black children, we're all terrified. It feels sometimes like a Russian roulette. You know, whose son is it going to be next? You know, I somehow thought that George Floyd murder was going to be the end of it, that was the drop that filled it, and that was it. And so, just before the verdict, they killed another one. And, you know, Dante writes, I he looks like my son. And so you wonder, you know, will he be next?
The killings haunt Thorin, but they've propelled Isak to the front lines, organizing and protesting since he was 16. There was the fatal shooting of Jamar Clark by Minneapolis police after a confrontation in 2015. And less than a year later, the fatal police shooting of Philando Castile during a traffic stop in a Twin Cities suburb. After George Floyd's death, Isak went straight to the square. It shook him, he said, to his core.
I shed tears for the first time in years because in ways I felt like we failed him. A lot of the reasons I'm fighting so hard for George Floyd's legacy and is because it's for Philando and for Jamar. You know, just in my short life in Minneapolis, like, you know, I witnessed a whole lot of nasty body cam footage from Minnesota police departments.
For John Thompson, the footage of his friend, Philando Castile, shook him into action.
I've never protested or none of this stuff. Like, yo, and then you murder my friend. I promised Philando, I'm looking at his casket. I'm saying, man, I'm gonna make sure this state remember your name.
He left work as a machinist, ran for a seat in the Minnesota House of Representatives, and won in a landslide. His focus as a lawmaker, police reform. The Democrat-controlled House in Minnesota has passed measures limiting traffic stops and requiring the quick release of body cam footage, but they're stuck in the Republican-run Senate.
There's going to be another dead man this year by the hands of law enforcement, and it's going to be because of this building that we're sitting in right now. The opposition is people who honestly don't live in the neighborhoods. And so they can't believe it's happening, or they don't want to believe it's happening, or they just don't care. Have we made any progress since Philando was murdered? No.
Back at George Floyd Square, progress is clearly defined. Marsha Howard and others have drafted 24 demands for officials, what they call Justice Resolution 001.
This is not some grandstanding or a vanity project. We're not a bunch of zealots standing on a barricade trying to burn down the world. We're attempting to affect change to address historical injustices.
There's been progress on some things on the list. Derek Chauvin's conviction, economic investment in the neighborhood, and an independent probe of the Minneapolis police. But until all the demands are met, Marsha says, the barricades stay up.
What we say is injustice is what closes these streets. Shouldn't justice be the only thing that opens them?
While Marsha and others reimagine community at the square, others in Minneapolis are reimagining policing in the city. In November, residents will likely vote on a measure to replace the city police department with the Department of Public Safety, moving away from some traditional policing methods. The debate comes as Minneapolis, like other cities, sees a spike in violent crime. Minneapolis Mayor Jacob Frey says that increase is among the reasons why the city shouldn't defund the police. Others disagree. Minneapolis Police Chief Madera Arredondo declined our interview request. But Sasha Cotton, who runs the city's Office of Violence Prevention, agreed to sit down with us. Her office, launched in 2018, works to interrupt violence by training and deploying teams to de-escalate conflicts. The city more than doubled their budget for 2021, some of it from funds earmarked for the police department.
If the goals of the city are to innovate and create public safety in a new way, the budget will need to long-term reflect that.
But city budgets are finite items, right? Yeah. You have $164 million going to police and only $7.5 million for you. Some folks would say that's an easy place. Funds can be reallocated.
And I wouldn't necessarily disagree with them. If we stay disproportionately budgeted compared to our other public safety partners, that our work will stay incrementally smaller than what they're able to do as well.
Budgets are one thing, but people here in Minneapolis say what will take longer and be harder to address is what you can't measure, the trauma Black residents carry.
All of a sudden, I just spiraled down.
Last year, Cherie Hansen formed a practice focusing on therapy for people of color. When they started seeing patients shortly after George Floyd's death, they were flooded with requests. Hansen says almost all of her clients talk about race.
If you put yourself around Black folk who live in this city, there is this air of fear underneath. Like you can feel it. Like you can walk in the room and you can just taste it almost. It's like an underlying fear. It's underlying anticipation of something bad happening.
For years, Isak carried the weight of that trauma without fully knowing it. He ignored his mother's push to therapy.
Being a young, African-American man, Like, you're socialized to be a protector and strong and rough and tough. I think it's seen as kind of like a sign of weakness.
But last year at George Floyd Square, he saw a man shot and killed. His mom pushed him again.
It's something that is going to stick with me really for the rest of my life. I decided this time not to be stubborn about it after she said that, like, maybe since you feel so numb to all of this, that's even more reason to go.
What's up, y'all? This is the To Keep It Above podcast.
He's trying to pay it forward, starting a podcast focused on mental health and evangelizing therapy among skeptical friends.
People are like, I've been through so much. I'm so strong, I know I don't need therapy.
That's what they tell you.
You know what I'm saying? You're just like, well, it sounds kind of like you're the person who needs it the most, right? Like, if you've been through all this and you're just good, like, that's where I felt like I was at. I was like, man, I don't need this. And then you sit down in that chair and suddenly you're like, man, wow, I'm really messed up, you know? Like, this has been a really traumatic experience growing up in Minneapolis.
Just steps from George Floyd Square, Isak's father, Remy, has his own way of healing that trauma. Almost every day for the past year, he's come here to the Say Their Name Cemetery. It's a memorial to more than 100 lives lost in police killings. He sets up chairs and waits.
How often does someone come sit next to you?
You'll be surprised, so often.
Really?
Yes.
And they just start talking?
They start talking.
What do they say?
Some just cry, and I just listen. You have so much on your chest, you want to talk to another human being. And if you can do it here, it's healthier than trying to take that all the way back to the square and then to your home and not talking to anyone.
As they talk, Remy says he always asks three questions. What makes you happy? When's the last time you were happy? And this.
The last question is, what can we do to get you to the space where you want to be happy? And that's when they start smiling. And that's what I want them to live with, a smile on their faces. Because we need to celebrate those guys who are in a special club of their own. George would like to smile, not to feel sad, because he was a joyful guy.
At the square bearing George Floyd's name, Marsha Howard mans her post at the Western Barrier. She'll be back in a classroom one day, she says. But right now, she's right where she needs to be.
I think about the fight that we're fighting now, and it was my mother's fight and my grandmother's fight. No one should rest until justice is served. The city killed a man. They did wrong, and they have an opportunity to make it right. That's what we're waiting for.
Are you hopeful they will do what you think it will take to make it right?
Yes. I am. Where there's people, there's power. Fundamentally, we are the city, and the city is us.
The murder of George Floyd ignited those enormous waves of anger, frustration, and demands for change. But the movement was growing well before that, with the deaths of other black people at the hands of police. That included Michael Brown, who died in 2014 in Ferguson, Missouri, a suburb of St. Louis. Yamiche Alcindor looks at what has changed since Brown's death and whether St. Louis can overcome its long, fraught history around race.
It was a cloudy day on August 9, 2014, here in Ferguson, Missouri, when a black unarmed teenager, Michael Brown, was shot and killed here on Canfield Drive by a white police officer, Darren Wilson. Out of that, a protest movement grew that lasted months. They demanded that the officer be charged. Ultimately, the officer was not charged. Other changes did come. Ferguson got a new mayor and a new police chief. In St. Louis City, a new prosecutor, also a new mayor. But people want to see more. They hope that St. Louis, which has a history of racism and violence against black people, that this city can learn lessons that may help the rest of the nation. It was the launching point of the Lewis and Clark Expedition, the gateway to the West, the home of Budweiser and the Cardinals. St. Louis, a city steeped in American history. But the long legacy of racism here continues to shape the city.
We're approaching Bond Avenue, where a lot of the black families lived.
In 1917, Dottie Kennedy's family was living on the other side of the Mississippi River in East St. Louis, Illinois. At the time, it was an industrial city experiencing tensions between black and white residents. That year, black laborers were recruited to work in one of the city's major factories,
after the white workers went on strike.
Rumors were spread that these Negroes are coming from the South and they're going to take our jobs, they're going to steal our way of life.
In July, that hostility turned deadly and into one of the largest race riots in U.S. history.
White mobs moved into the neighborhoods, firebombed a lot of the houses, and they would stand around the house and wait for somebody to run out so they could shoot and kill them. If you were caught on the street, you were lynched.
Dottie's grandfather went missing during the massacre and was presumed dead. But despite the police and mobs blocking two bridges to safety, the rest of the Kennedy family escaped.
My grandmother was able to get her family, my father, our uncles, and all of them to safety across the Mississippi River on a raft that they'd built and fashioned out of burnt out doors and everything wooden they could find.
Dottie says this legacy of dehumanizing and driving out black people didn't end with what he calls the East St. Louis race war.
Why do you think it's so important to keep that history alive when we think about what happened in Ferguson, what happened to George Floyd, what's happening to African Americans and black people all over this country?
Well, the massacre itself was fueled by a trope about black men. They're rapists, they're thieves, they're murderers, they lie, they cheat, and they're lazy. That idea in many, many different forms still exists today.
No one really knows just how many people died in the massacre here in East St. Louis. But for the people who were lucky enough to make it out, a legacy of violence and racism followed them.
Across the river, many made a new home in St. Louis, in a neighborhood called Mill Creek Valley.
To me, it represents the depth of the history in St. Louis.
Harvard historian Walter Johnson is a Missouri native and author of the 2020 book, The Broken Heart of America, St. Louis, and the Violent History of the United States. The book details the city's role as a center first of Native American removal and later of exploitation, violence, and the forced migration of black people within the city and beyond. Following the massacre, Mill Creek Valley became a hub for black homes, businesses, and culture.
It's about 500 acres. 20,000 people lived there, 800 business and cultural institutions. Mill Creek Valley was destroyed by urban redevelopment and real estate speculation. But I think they left five or six buildings standing.
It's now filled with highways, municipal services, and many empty lots. As black people were cleared out of that neighborhood, many were forced north into the Pruitt-Igoe housing project.
Pruitt-Igoe was one of the largest housing projects in the United States, and certainly the most famous and the most notorious.
Johnson took us to the site where 33 11-story buildings once stood. It is now an overgrown lot. Pruitt-Igoe was advertised as safe, affordable housing for the city's working class and poor, but Johnson says it was neglected almost immediately. Over the years, it became a place to unfairly target black people through experimental policing.
The experiment was to pull over, to randomly target as many young black people as they could, and then to identify those who they thought might become offenders and arrest them on pretextuous charges.
What you're describing then is racial profiling tied to housing.
Absolutely.
Raw sewage bubbles out of the ground like a malevolent spring.
With a focus on policing instead of maintenance, conditions at the housing project deteriorated. And after just two decades of occupation, it was demolished. Once again, black people were pushed further north, some beyond city limits, to Ferguson, Missouri. Walter Johnson argues black people here have been regularly exploited through disinvestment and police harassment in the form of fines and fees. All while major tax subsidies are given to corporations in this community, like Emerson Electric.
How is it you have a community, a city, where the police are farming black motorists for traffic tickets when you have a $24 billion corporation in the city limits?
Hands up, don't shoot! Hands up, don't shoot!
In 2014, those decades of segregation, police harassment, and violence against black people came to a head when Michael Brown was killed by Officer Darren Wilson. Protesters, activists, and neighbors poured into the streets demanding change. The protests lasted months.
No justice, no peace.
But what has actually changed since then? 5 years ago, the Department of Justice entered into a consent decree with the city of Ferguson. It's an attempt to reform the police department's policies and practices. As of 2019, traffic stops of black people are down nearly 50% from 2014, and ticketing of black residents is down 60%.
I know that we will win!
And over the past 5 years, progressive black candidates won a handful of races, most recently for St. Louis mayor.
I, Tashara O. Jones.
A native of Northside St. Louis, Tashara Jones is the city's first black woman mayor.
The activists see this election as their chance to finally have someone on the inside that will not only work with them and listen to them, but also implement some of the strategies that they've been calling for.
One of the people who kept that momentum going is Kayla Reed.
We're still dealing with and learning the names of folks who are being killed by police. We're still seeing most instances of that not resulting in any sort of charges or conviction.
In the months following Michael Brown's killing, Reed threw herself into organizing. She eventually started Action St. Louis, a grassroots group that advocates for racial justice.
What's the connection you see between Michael Brown and George Floyd?
The movement that was sparked in Ferguson, I see remnants of it and legacy of it and continuations of it and new iterations of it happening in these other cities. And I think that we're still in that movement. We're still perfecting the demands. We're still perfecting the policies, and we're going after power now.
She is confident, though, that these new political leaders are a helpful step in that transformation.
The win is not representation. The win is action. It's not just getting someone in the seat. It's ensuring that once they're in that seat, that they do the things that we know are going to transform our communities.
In the month that Mayor Jones has been in office, she's defunded the Workhouse, a medium security facility long criticized for its inhumane conditions. And she reallocated 2% of the police department's budget to social workers, counselors, and a housing fund. It's a move that some have criticized as the city continues to struggle with violent crime.
Homicide numbers in the city of St. Louis paint a bleak picture.
Last year, the city saw its highest murder rate in 50 years.
Number one, we need to declare gun violence as a public health crisis. But also, crime and violence doesn't stop at our borders. We have to look at the entire region, which also includes our neighbors to the east in East St. Louis, our neighbors to the west and north in St. Louis County. We have to bring all the people to the table because our destinies are linked and shared, and we have to address this as such.
But in the years since Michael Brown's death, police killings in St. Louis haven't gone down. One report says that of the 100 largest cities, St. Louis police have killed the most people per capita since 2013. Mayor Jones's 13-year-old son is a reminder of just how much work still needs to be done.
We were having a conversation about what the mayor does, and when I got to the police, he says, well, mommy, you'll be over the police? I said, yes. He said, well, that means I'll be safe. And it hit me like a ton of bricks because it gave him a false sense of security, in my opinion, that he thought he would be safe because I became mayor.
St. Louis has a high poverty rate, St. Louis has a high violence rate, and St. Louis has a high police violence rate. We have to address the fact that where violence happens, there's lack of resources, there's historical neglect, and there's complete disillusionment with the system.
Jones is hoping a $500 million infusion of federal stimulus money for things like housing, broadband, and workforce development will also help address the lack of resources. She and others find hope in St. Louis's long history of activism. Throughout the 20th century, black demonstrators led protests over fair pay, working conditions, and hiring practices. Dottie Kennedy believes to be successful today, there are important lessons from that past.
It just can't be legislative or just political. It has to be grassroots, but it can't just be grassroots. It's going to have to be a lot of things to come together, put all of those cogs in the wheel together, and we can move forward.
And to those seeking change here in St. Louis and around the country, Kayla Reed says it will take a lifetime commitment.
This is a long-term work plan that we all have to commit to. There is real human cost to getting this right, and we have to get this right because we're going to keep losing people if we don't.
When George Floyd died last May, there had already been another high-profile police killing in Louisville, Kentucky, one that gave rise to protests as well. The case highlighted that city's long-standing racial divisions and became a national rallying cry in its own right. John Yang reports.
It was about 12:40 on the morning of March 13, 2020, that Louisville police
used a battering ram to burst into an apartment in this complex belonging to a 26-year-old emergency room technician named Breonna Taylor. The officers were executing a no-knock warrant, but the warrant wasn't for Taylor or anyone else who was in the apartment. Taylor's boyfriend thought someone was breaking in. He grabbed his gun, fired a single shot. The police fired back. When it was all over, Taylor lay dying on her hallway floor, shot several times. In the years since, Louisville has grieved, protested, and debated policing changes. One thing it hasn't done, many residents say, is heal. After a long investigation by the state attorney general, no one was charged with Breonna Taylor's death. But now the federal Justice Department is investigating the Louisville police, looking to see if there's been a pattern and practice of discrimination and abuse. Many residents here say it's about time.
YouTube, come up here. So
Shamika Parrish-Wright may feel the weight of Louisville on her shoulders when she wakes up in the morning, but her days start with her duties as a mom.
All right, I got a few meetings and then I'll be back.
She's spent years working as an advocate for criminal justice reform, but the killing of Breonna Taylor changed everything for Parrish-Wright and for Louisville.
I have three daughters in their 20s. One of them went to school with Breonna. And so for them, it hit home. And the first night of the protest, we were at my table and I said, this could have been any of you.
As cities across the country rose up to protest police brutality and systemic racism last summer, she felt called to lead the movement in her city. In May 2020, just days after George Floyd's death, Taylor family attorneys released 911 tapes from the night of Taylor's death, sparking protests over what many black residents said was a long history of police misconduct and racial profiling.
They couldn't drag her down and say, oh, she had warrants, oh, she was this criminal, and they couldn't do that to her. And so I think that that's what invigorated people to say, if we let this happen to her, and she's supposed to be safe at home, she's an essential worker, and she dies in her home, then none of us are safe. And then George Floyd sent us overboard.
Parrish-Wright has been a guiding force in this downtown park, the protest center of gravity.
We built this as a place for people to bring all that energy.
Officially named Jefferson Square Park, it sits directly across from Louisville's Metro Hall.
We called it Injustice Square because it's surrounded by where justice is supposed to happen.
There is no justice, Parrish-Wright says, as long as the three officers who fired their weapons that night are free, though one of them was indicted for shooting into her neighbor's apartment.
They're showing the world how they treat us as citizens.
Some protesters say their experience with police over the last year only underscores the need for change.
I remember the police officers and the SWAT just coming at us.
Ari Toule was 19 years old when she joined the early protests last May.
As soon as we reached the blockade, we stopped, and that's when the chemical agents started to be fired, the rubber bullets started to be fired, and it was, you know, turned into a war zone. About 100 of us were arrested that night, and then I was one of the last five to be released about 30 hours later. So it was an intense experience. I mean, jail is incredibly dehumanizing.
But Toule found humanity among the crowd in jail that night, an experience, she says, that moved her to keep protesting.
There needed to be a disruption to the way things were to be able to have people see us. And I mean, I always think anger is painted as a negative in protest movements and just in the black community, that we're not allowed to be angry because that can be misconstrued. But it's anger because we know that there's a reality in which this doesn't have to happen.
Anger at leaders like Greg Fisher, mayor of Louisville since 2010.
I think that history will show that we've done most everything we possibly could toward moving toward truth and transparency, toward justice within the power that I have.
Louisville banned the kind of no-knock warrants that gave police license to break into Breonna Taylor's home as she lay sleeping. And the Metro Council also established a civilian review board to investigate police misconduct. But the state legislature hasn't given it the power to compel testimony and evidence from anyone beyond Metro government employees, something both activists and Fisher say the board needs to effectively investigate cases.
I'm disappointed that didn't happen here this past session. The public wants to know more about what's taking place with police investigations. There's just not enough transparency. And when there's not transparency, there's not trust. Chief?
In January, many found that trust further tested when Fisher appointed Erica Shields the new police chief. She had quit as Atlanta's police chief after a video of an officer fatally shooting a black man, Rayshard Brooks, went viral.
I was like, wait a minute, she left. She quit what happened with Rayshard Brooks, and she's coming here to heal and fix us?
Well, I can understand why people would have that concern, and I knew it was going to be a controversial decision. But Chief Shields was so far above everybody else in terms of her being a candidate for this job that it was an easy decision to make, and I think she's won over most of her critics.
But a year since protests erupted in Louisville, critics remain of Fisher, of Shields, and of a police force that some residents say continues to abuse its power. These tensions aren't just about police and the community. Protesters say those issues tie into centuries of racist policies that shaped the very development of the city. To see the results, drive west on Muhammad Ali Boulevard, a main thoroughfare.
There's something called the 9th Street Divide in Louisville, and on one side of 9th Street, your life expectancy can be seen to be 15 years higher, less likely of asthma, less likely of eczema, and on the other side of 9th Street, that's known as the West End, and you're going to have a lower life expectancy, higher rate of heart disease. So growing up around that, it's a visual difference. It's obvious, and it makes you then question the motive.
It was all by design. A 1914 ordinance barred black Louisville residents from occupying houses on majority white blocks and the other way around. Then in the 1930s, so-called redlining maps color-coded city neighborhoods based on how desirable lenders considered them for investment. Desirable usually meant white. Black and immigrant areas were typically given the lowest grades. Louisville's history of redlining has concentrated black residents into West End neighborhoods like this one, called Russell. In the early part of the 20th century, this was a thriving hub of black business and culture. But decades of disinvestment have driven many residents into poverty. Today, the black home ownership rate in Louisville is half of what it is for white residents.
All of these vacant lots didn't exist.
Kevin Dunlap was born in Russell.
Used to ride my bicycle down this street. I mean, it was a thriving area growing up as a child. Over time, just seeing what the transition has been is very disheartening to see.
Dunlap is the executive director of Rebound, the nonprofit housing arm of Louisville's Urban League. He points to government urban renewal policies in the 1950s and 60s that resulted in the demolition of majority black areas.
You begin to see people begin to move out or were displaced as a result of urban renewal. But as you begin to start buying a property and acquiring property, you know, there was no need for other people didn't want to stay next to undeveloped property. And it kind of wiped out the business sector that was part of the heart of the African-American community.
Dunlap's group is working with the Metro Louisville government to increase black home ownership in the West End. City officials acknowledge Louisville needs more than 30,000 additional units of affordable housing.
In the city of Louisville, we have a housing crisis.
Like Dunlap, Ja'Cory Arthur was born and raised in the West End. Last year, at 28, he was elected Louisville's youngest member of the Metro Council.
When you can't afford to live here in the neighborhood with the highest rate of poverty, you can't afford to live anywhere. And to a certain extent, you could argue you're not supposed to afford to live at all. You really got three options. You could be houseless in a junkyard, you can be imprisoned in a prison yard, or you'll be dead in a graveyard.
Nashan Trabue is a fourth-generation resident of Smoketown, a historically black neighborhood just southeast of downtown.
You have 22% black population. You have 2.4% that are business owners. We should have 10 times as more business owners. We don't have access to capital. We don't have access to resources. And that's the missing piece that we're not able to build, is the generational wealth piece.
Trabue says housing disparities touch so many other aspects of life in the neighborhood. Lower income areas like Smoketown and Russell have higher crime rates, which means more policing.
Do you think it's a conversation and a worry that white mothers on the east side of Louisville have?
No, no. No. They don't have this type of a worry. Our worries are different. They're worried about what soccer game are they getting ready to go to, and I'm worried about can my son even go to the bus stop without, you know, getting mistakenly identified as somebody that he's not and getting shot and killed.
Ja'Cory Arthur doesn't want to wait for the slow work of police reform to better Louisville's black neighborhoods.
As long as we stand in Russell, that has the highest percentage of poverty, you are going to have the highest percentages of crime. Thus, you're going to call who, whenever those crimes are committed, you're going to call the police. And in some cases, they escalate those situations. So I'm less worried about the police and more worried about addressing poverty.
Shamika Parrish Wright wants to tackle some of those root causes in a new role. She's running for mayor, seeking to channel the passion of the protest movement toward meaningful reform. Meanwhile, the long search for justice in Louisville is just beginning.
We haven't seen the accountability that Breonna deserves, that our city deserves, but we are starting to see that people are waking up, and I don't think people are ever going to go back to sleep.
The three cities we profile tonight, Minneapolis, St. Louis, and Louisville, have been on the knife's edge when it comes to policing and broader racial inequities. But there are many places in America grappling with similar questions. We look at all this now with three guests. DeRay McKesson is co-founder of Campaign Zero, an organization aimed at ending police violence. Margaret Huang is president and CEO of the Southern Poverty Law Center, a civil rights organization. And Rosa Brooks is a Georgetown University law professor who 5 years ago became a reserve police officer in Washington, D.C. to try to better understand the profession. Brooks writes of that experience in her new book, Tangled Up in Blue. And I want to thank you all for being here with us. We appreciate it. And DeRay McKesson, to you first. This country has been dealing with race and all of the issues around it from its very beginning. How does the death of George Floyd fit into that complicated history?
You know, in so many ways, we've been here before. One conviction doesn't change the demand for justice. And remember that the police kill on average 1,100 people a year, and the highest number of convictions for this set of officers ever in a given year is 11. So when you look at the numbers, you know, the numbers continue to be bad. The police killed more people in 2020 than every single year of data we have, except for 2018. And already in 2021, the police have killed over 400 people. So, you know, I do think that the death of George Floyd was an awakening, a reawakening for a lot of people, and helped them understand that this is systemic. This is not just in one city, but this is happening all over the country. Now the next step is how do we make sure that we get results that actually make the problem go away?
Margaret Huang is somebody who looks at human rights broadly and focuses very much on racial injustice. What do you think the country's learned since the death of George Floyd and the reaction to it?
Judy, the system of policing that we have in this country actually started at the beginning of the founding of our country as a slave patrol system. Police officers were created to track down slaves and to bring them back to their owners in the Deep South. And it's why today we still see remnants of the origins of that system in the way that police are trained and the way that police are responding to situations on the ground. That's why it's so important that we reckon with the racial history of our country, that we understand how white supremacy undergirds all of our institutions and our structures of governance and law enforcement. If we don't reckon with that, then we're not going to be able to move forward.
And Rosa Brooks, you teach law, that's your career, but you did take time out to study policing. You became a reserve police officer, as we said, and spent time on the beat. What did you learn about policing in that period? You said at one point you learned how hard it is to be a cop. What did that mean?
We pile so many contradictory tasks on police right now, in part because we have essentially, in most parts of the United States, eviscerated other social services. So at the moment, We are expecting police to enforce civil traffic regulations, to be mediators, to be social workers, to be medics, to do all kinds of things that really do not and should not require an armed response. And a lot of those situations end up being really fraught. And for all the reasons that Dre and Margaret have already highlighted, the more you have contacts and enforcement contacts between armed police and members of the public, the more possibility you have for things to go badly, fatally wrong.
And given that, Dre, what are some things that would make a difference in this country? I mean, your organization looks at it every day. What would make the most difference, and what do you see in states that are already moving to try to make changes?
Hey, you know, one of the biggest misconceptions is that people are like, the police are above the law. And you're like, they're actually not above the law, I would say, is that they actually just have their own set of laws. Like, that's a part of the problem, that it's just a completely different standard for the police. So we look across the country, there are 20 states that have what we call police officer bill of rights, that are state-level protections that essentially protect the police from accountability. So like in California, the law says that any investigation of an officer that lasts more than a year can never result in discipline, regardless of the outcome. That doesn't make sense. In Louisiana, the law says that officers who engage in misconduct get 30 days before they can even be asked any question. Maryland is actually the first state that ever had one of those laws. And importantly, this year, the first state to repeal such a law. So there is progress happening. There is hope. Use of force policies matter. Restricting no-knock raids matter. Police unions have a lot of power. And breaking that power so that we don't inhibit rules around accountability is actually a really big deal. So those are some of the things. And the George Floyd Act, you know, there are some good things that are in it. And I know that Cory Booker's team and a host of other people are working on revisions. So I think that the next set that we see will have even more of the demands that have risen up from community over the past year.
Margaret Wong, as you listen to this, as you listen to the remedies that are out there, whether they are enacted or not, which ones do you see making the most difference?
Judy, I think one of the most important things to do is to actually acknowledge the history of the Confederacy and to put it away for once and for all. In this country, there are still more than 1,700 symbols of the Confederacy, monuments, statues, buildings named after Confederate generals. These every day are a signal to people of color, and particularly to Black people in this country, that they're still not equal. And if we're going to make this change happen, we have to eliminate the symbols that perpetuate the undergirding structural racism that is around.
Rosa Brooks, connect that to what you see inside the police and how they think about what their job is every single day in this country.
I think police are confused. They're as confused as the rest of us. A lot of people join policing because they want to help people. They often were crime victims themselves or close to someone who's a crime victim. But the job makes them quite cynical, in part because you're seeing people often in the worst moments of their lives. They're angry, they're distressed, et cetera. It can lead police officers to feel like there's nothing much good in humanity. And that's that cynicism, I think, is a reason that suicide kills more police officers each year than every other cause combined. I think also police officers, like the rest of America, are really struggling. And in Washington, D.C., for instance, where we do have a majority Black police department, where some of the types of reforms and changes that Dre was talking about have improved the department significantly in the last 20 years, we have a lot of officers who are really, I think, struggling because they want to be doing things that are good, but they recognize that they're caught up in a system that in all kinds of ways does perpetuate racial injustice.
And Dre, coming back to you on that point, what message do you want to send to police, individual police officers, about how they see their job and how they treat all Americans?
Yeah, in some ways, I don't think this is really an issue about the individuals. I'm mindful that the individuals do make choices, right? So when the police say this is hard, it's like you choose to kill somebody, you choose to harm people, like that's a choice. But I'm also mindful that we need to move away from policing as a response to all crises or conflicts in communities, right? So when I hear people say police now, I just swap that out with the phrase person with the gun, because that's really what people mean. And it's like, do you need a person with a gun to respond to somebody with suicidal ideation? You don't. Do you need a person with a gun to be the person that tells you that you don't have your taillight? on? Like, you don't, right? The police actually are the first people to tell us that they're doing too much. They're not social workers. They're, not, they're the first. And the moment that we agree with them and say, cool, let's move away from policing and go to preventative work or social services or other interventions in conflict that are not people with guns, then they freak out. And I think that we actually just have to normalize this understanding that there are a host of ways to deal with conflict that are not calling people with guns, which is what the police are.
You know, on the one place where I would disagree slightly with DeRay is I think it is possible to enlist police officers themselves in being part of that change. Because I think when you shift the conversation from, we just want to take away your resources but leave you doing exactly the same things you're doing now, which makes officers go, how? Whoa, that doesn't work. And change that conversation to, what do you do now that you don't think you ought to be doing, that you're not good at? What do you do now that is not effective because there aren't other city services that can be there and be supportive of what you do? You get a really different conversation, and I think it is possible to move away from the conversation that leaves cops feeling defensive and towards one that leaves them feeling like, yeah, you know, that's a good point. If we shrank the kinds of things we do, we could actually have less money and we could be more effective. So I don't think it's impossible. That said, I very much think it's right. It's not really about individual officers. Police don't exist in a vacuum. They reflect all the problems of our broader society.
The only thing I push a little bit is a reminder that shrinking the role or the footprint is also shrinking the number of officers, right? And I don't think, you know, the data doesn't show that that means more crime. We actually might be intervening and responding to things before crimes happen, which is actually a cool thing, right? That our work can't be rooted in only responding to bad things. Our work has to actually be rooted in making sure that the bad things don't happen in the first place. So we think about the effects of poverty. We think about, like, how communities are designed in ways to create conflict. These are policy choices. Homelessness is a policy choice. Poverty is a policy choice. We could actually set people up with a whole different set of options on the front end so that we don't deal with these back-end effects.
And Rosa Brooks, how do we restore trust between the police and the communities they're there to serve?
It is not an uncomplicated story. You know, that when you look at public polling on confidence in policing, it's very uneven, but it's not rock bottom, even in low-income communities of color. There are still plenty of people who do want to work with police. They don't necessarily want fewer police. They want better and different and more responsive policing. So I think it'll happen. I do just wanted to return to something interesting that DeRay said. One of the fascinating things about the COVID pandemic is that crime did not go up. Homicides went up in a number of American cities, but overall crime actually went down. And that's interesting both because it was during a period of extreme economic hardship for many Americans, and it was during a period in which police in many municipalities, not all, but many, adopted a deliberate policy of reducing the types of situations, the number of situations to which armed officers were sent, simply because every interaction created a risk of infection for both the officers and everybody else involved. And the sky did not fall. You know, so we're just coming out of a forced natural experiment in what happens if you reduce the amount of policing for minor things in many communities. And so far, the results suggest that you don't necessarily get more crime, you know, that you can do that and nothing terrible will happen, which in itself, I think, is a really hopeful indicator for those who think we should be doing a whole lot less policing and, frankly, criminalizing many fewer minor misdeeds.
And something else that has come out. Go ahead, DeRay.
I just want to say, you know, what did stay constant during the pandemic, though, was police killings. The police killed more people last year than they did in every other year we have data for, except for 2018. People weren't even outside.
And Margaret Hwang, this question of restoring trust to the extent it was there, how do you rebuild, how do you recreate trust between the police and the communities they're serving?
Actions always speak louder than words. What we need to see is actually a transformation in the way policing departments respond in communities. And I think we have some interesting models that are now being adopted across the country, and we have a lot of interesting conversations happening about how police can show up differently in communities. What we need to see is buy-in from the police, but also from the elected officials who oversee them. And we need to see buy-in from communities. Communities have to have a stake in the direction we're going in, and communities need to be consulted on how we do this well.
It's a time of many, many hard questions that we're all trying to address, and we want to thank the three of you for joining us for this special program, DeRay McKesson, Margaret Huang, Rosa Brooks. Thank you. Thank you, each one of you.
Thank you, Judy.
Whatever comes from efforts to improve relations between Black Americans and the police and race relations overall in this country, the murder of George Floyd was a historic marker. It galvanized and mobilized many here and around the world to say no more. It ignited countless public debates about policy and millions of private conversations about attitudes. And it reminds us that what sets this nation apart is the constant striving to do better. In order to form that more perfect union laid out in our Constitution, we have no choice but to keep working, keep talking, keep striving toward better policing, more engaged communities that make the safety and well-being of all Americans the priority of all of us. I'm Judy Woodruff. Thank you for watching.
This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
PBS.